you pray with me? Father, we give you great thanks that you are someone who gives us your divine presence. It is often lost on us, but we now bring our full attention to you. We want to bring our full selves, everything that's going on, all those busy things that make our weeks fly by, we bring them to your feet. And we ask that you allow us to just embrace our lives, everything that you throw our way, and that we would live our lives like Jesus would live them. So God, be with us as we look at your word. And please, Lord, we ask that you would send help to those who are suffering through hardship right now. We think especially of all those who are displaced and disrupted by Hurricane Ian, Lord. Will you please rush help to their side? We ask that in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I'm thrilled to be with you. And just like that happens in worship, you know, for me, sometimes just a verse sticks out. I try to make note of it. I feel like it's God trying to grab my attention. I hope that happens during the sermon. You don't need to remember everything I say. That's not the point of this. The point, hopefully, is that God speaks something to you. But I would encourage you, in any way you need to do that, make note of that. Whatever God grabs your attention with this morning, take it with you and put it into practice. And so hopefully that'll happen through this second chapter of the book of Acts that we'll look at this morning. Now, so often, I need to just rewind. We're already in chapter 2, but I need to rewind a little bit because I haven't got to preach on Acts yet, even though it was my idea, right? So, you know, we've been calling it the book of Acts, and that's a fine title for it, but it's not full. It's not the best. I get it. It's short. It's four letters. Like, it kind of gets the job done. But I think there's more accurate titles for it. Now, do you know, the book of Acts actually has kind of a longer formal title. Do you know, it's called the Acts of the Apostles. Right. Okay, great. So that's a little bit longer, harder to say. But even that, I think, is wrong. I'm reading this great book. It's a page-turner. And in the intro, it talks about the book of Acts as being mistitled. And he said, you know, a lot of times we call it just Acts, the book of Acts, the Acts of the Apostles. He said, but that's not really giving credit where credit is due. So this author explores what might be more appropriate titles for the book of Acts. One stab at it is the Acts of God through the Apostles. See, you see what he's doing. When you call it the Acts of the Apostles, it feels like the Apostles are the main people that we should be drawing our attention towards. But this author says, no, this is God. This is God's activity in the world. It happens through the Apostles, but our attention should be drawn to him. In fact, he says, well, and maybe that's, you know, not necessarily fully accurate. He goes and says, well, maybe we should call the book the Acts of the Holy Spirit. But this author, in his book, he kind of grows frustrated. He said, but even that's not fully sufficient. So let me tell you the title that he thinks it should actually be called by, and I think you'll find out why we just call it the book of Acts. He says, the book should be titled, The Acts of the Risen Lord Jesus Through His People by the Holy Spirit for the Accomplishment of God's Purposes. Fully accurate, a little cumbersome, right? But what I love about that title, why I wanted to put it up in your eyesight today, is that it does tell the story of what actually is happening in the book of Acts. It is the risen Lord Jesus acting in human history. He already had, and in, you know, dying and being raised from the grave didn't slow him down one bit. He's working in a different way. Now he gives his Holy Spirit to all those who call on his name and put their trust in him. And so he is still working now. The risen Lord Jesus Christ working through his people. And in today's language, that's you and that's me. Working through his people by the Holy Spirit for the accomplishment of God's purposes. See, the Bible would go on to tell that story. They would say in Philippians, for it is God who works in you to will and to act in order to fulfill his good purpose. When we read the book of Acts, my hope is that the person's work chiefly on display is God's and that we don't forget it. God always uses human actors to get his work done. But the primary mover all throughout the book of Acts is God. And so we're going to look at this section today where God uses Peter to preach what is often called the first sermon. But I have more bad news for you. Not only do I think we mistitle the book of Acts, I like the longer title, but we'll just go with Acts for right now. I also think referring to what we'll look at today as the first sermon is completely wrong. Now, if you were to look it up, like commentator after commentator refer to what we're going to read today as the first sermon. Even Tim Keller, a man who, you know, is near and dear to my heart. He's a pastor that I got to have lunch with one time way long ago. Long story. I read all of his books. He even refers to it as the first sermon. And so I have to, like, I feel a little treasonous going against what he thinks. But I don't think this is the first sermon. You might think this is the first sermon, but I disagree. See, let me tell you why. As soon as you start to call this a sermon, it limits who could do what Peter will do. Who preaches sermons? Pastors, preachers. Maybe in an odd circumstance, a guy who lost a weird bet has to preach a sermon one time, right? Maybe you think of just like, you know, disciples, like 401 level Christians are preaching sermons, right? I don't think it is accurate to call what Peter does preaching the first sermon, because this book all started with Jesus. He had lived his life and done his ministry. He had died. He had been resurrected. But this is before he ascends to heaven. And he grabs his disciples and his followers together. And he says, you will be my what? You will be my witnesses. What does a witness do? They say something about what they have seen and experienced. Peter, as he steps up into this space and starts to testify, to give witness about what Jesus has done and who he really is, I think that this is something that you and I should all find our place in, that we should see ourselves as being people that could do what Peter did. So don't leave this message of the gospel to the professionals. Right, again, I love to say this just because I think it's hysterical. I'm paid to be good. You guys get to be good for nothing. It took a second, right? The design of the Holy Spirit being given to all believers, is it so that we are all in this together? I'm going to talk a little bit more about that later. But as we look at this lengthy passage, I want to give us a roadmap of what we'll see in it. Now, it's long. I love the Bible. This is a, and I'm the one who, you know, kind of designed what is covered each week. For some reason, I thought going over 30 verses was like an easy thing to do. But it's not. But I did find a helpful summary in one of the commentaries I read this week. It's by a man named John Stott. And he, as he summarized this lengthy passage we'll look at, he saw four pairs of distinctives that we need to look at. You know, I got a third message of bad news. I think he was wrong. I think everybody's wrong today. I don't know what's wrong with me. I don't think there's just four pairs. I think that there is seven pairs of distinctives that we need to look at this morning to get the message that Peter's trying to convey. And I know what you're thinking. Only seven? I wish there were more. I know. But we'll just settle for seven this morning. Let me read you the summary that is John Stott with sprinkles of Adam Jackley. Here we go. Two questions. What does this mean and what shall we do? Lead Peter to talk about two events, Christ's death and resurrection, which reveal Jesus' two identities, Lord and Messiah, as confirmed by two witnesses, the Old Testament prophets and the New Testament apostles, on the basis of which God makes two promises, his forgiveness and his Holy Spirit, on two conditions, repentance and faith, so that we can fulfill two roles, that of prophet and preacher. That's it. That's all we have to get over this morning. All right, so let's get after it. The first thing that happens, Peter is standing in front of this crowd of people that just witnesses the Holy Spirit descend. And it's a completely mundane event, right? God falls from heaven. The tongues of flames of fire are resting on people's heads. Everybody is speaking in different languages. It seems pretty self-explanatory, but can you believe that the people watching this say this in verse 12? Amazed and perplexed, they ask one another, what does this mean? What Peter is responding to is the question of the people standing before him. They see this miraculous event happen, and they say, what does this mean? I think, actually, this is such a wonderful, I think this is the kind of question that you and I ought to hope we get. You know, we live our lives trying to follow Jesus and live and love like him. And I think we, do you know how nice it would be if someone came up to you and said, hey, friend, you go to church every Sunday. You give financially and generously to your church and other ministries. You give of your time. You forgive people who wrong you. You don't carry grudges. You work to resolve conflict. There's some things you do that are interesting. There's some things you abstain from that are interesting. What does that all mean? Wouldn't it be nice to get that question? right? To have it, we think, we kind of live in the world where actually evangelism feels like this like cold call. Like we just want to knock on their door and like, hey friend, it seems like you have a hole shaped like Jesus in your heart. Do you want to talk about it? I can tell you do. That's not how evangelism often happens. It would be so nice if someone approached us and said, you live this distinct kind of life. What does this mean? And this kind of question isn't lost on Peter. He seizes the opportunity. God does something in and through the people of God, and people watching that say, what does this mean? And Peter is ready to tell them. And after he tells them this lengthy discourse about the gospel, it's actually called in Greek the kerygma. It's the kind of early apostolic message. It's the basics of what is the gospel of Jesus Christ. So we are really in store for something amazing this morning. After Peter shares all that, a second question bookends this passage, and it's this. In verse 37, when the people heard this, they were cut to the heart, and they said to Peter and the other apostles, brothers, what shall we do? Now again, what a wonderful question to get at the end of some evangelistic message is, hey, I'm leaning in, I'm interested, what are the implications of what you just said? And Peter will tell them about what it is to enter into a saving relationship with Jesus. But what I love, and what I think we can model our life and comments after, is he says something that summons or begs a response. At the end of what he says to the people about the life and death and resurrection and ascension of Jesus, they are saying, wow, I guess that has implications on my life. What then shall I do? And that we are ready, not just to answer the questions that drive us into the gospel, but to answer what does it look like to lean into and respond to the gospel. So two questions, what does this mean and what shall we do, lead Peter to talk about two events, Christ's death and resurrection. The first we see in verse 23. It says, this man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross. Now, you got to love this. I don't think you'd find this speaking principle in Dale Carnegie's How to Win Friends and Influence People, right? You killed this great guy that I'm talking to you about. But what I love about what Peter does here is he puts on display the scandalous death of Jesus. It is hard to imagine how jarring this message would have been to those early hearers. To put Jesus' death at the core is to put the thing that would have seemed to invalidate all of Jesus' ministry. Jesus dying on the cross seemed like the thing that made him not the Messiah. It was scandalous. It was a source of shame and humiliation. That's how they put to death the worst of the worst criminals. It was actually referred to as a stumbling block to the Jews and foolishness to the Greeks. It seems like the thing that confirmed the opposite. And yet, Peter has the audacity to say that the death of Jesus Christ on the cross is exactly what God intended to do. By his, what does he say? By his deliberate plan and foreknowledge. But he doesn't absolve them of responsibility. He still calls them wicked people for doing it. Even though God's in control, even though God's sovereign, there's real human accountability to what happened to Jesus. And so Peter puts on display the death, but not just that. He has a great finale to these events. He talks about the resurrection of Jesus too. Verse 24. But God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him. God raised Jesus from the dead. Death had no claim on his life because of his faithfulness, his faultlessness, his perfect and precious life. Death had no power on Jesus. And so as Peter begins to answer the questions that people have in front of him, he points to both the death and the resurrection of Jesus as key events that they need to know about if they want to know Jesus. So two questions lead Peter to talk about these two events that reveal two identities of Jesus, that he is Lord and Messiah. Verse 36, therefore, let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, who you crucified, both Lord and Messiah. Jesus is Lord and Messiah. Now, what it seems like it may be saying is it God made him this in these moments. The reality is what Peter intends to say is that God revealed this as his identity. Jesus was always Lord and Messiah, and in the events that transpired around his life, death, resurrection, ascension, and exaltation to the right hand of the Father, God was revealing who Jesus really was. And he was Lord and Messiah. That word Lord is a loaded one. It is the same word used of God the Father all throughout the Old Testament. So when Jesus is called Lord, he is being called God. So don't let anybody ever tell you that Jesus was never called God in the New Testament. There's actually a theory, they call it the Messianic secret. I don't like it. I don't think it's true, because we see here that Jesus readily accepted the term Lord about him. And when you said Lord, you meant God. You called whoever you thought was the king of all kings Lord. Some people thought that was Caesar. Many people ended up thinking it was Jesus. And so when he says Jesus is Lord, he is saying he is God. He is ruler of heaven and of earth. He is the guy that's going to right all the wrongs and restore creation to what it was always intended to be. But he's not just that. He's Messiah. He isn't just this high, lofty king. He cares about redeeming you from your sin. He is the long-awaited rescuer and deliverer that Israel longed for generations upon generations. And so if you think about it, Jesus as Lord focuses on his kingship. Jesus as Messiah focuses on the salvation he brought. Okay, we're making some progress. We see two questions that led Peter to talk about two events that revealed two identities of Jesus confirmed by two kinds of witnesses. The first are the Old Testament prophets. Now, if you read that whole section, verses 12 through 41, you actually see that they talk about David a lot. And we don't always think of David as a prophet, but he's referred to it as someone who gives prophecy. Now, I'll tell you what I mean by that in a second, but let me show you how the life, death, resurrection, all the ministry of Jesus was confirmed by these prophets and predicted by it. It says this: in the last days, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. And he's quoting the Old Testament book of Joel. Now, he is saying that that prediction, that thing that the prophets in the Old Testament thought would happen, as revealed to them by God, is happening real time before your eyes through the ministry of Jesus. That great democratizing of the faith, that every person gets the full-fledged, 100% Holy Spirit, liberating them and empowering them, is happening in their midst. And what I love is he says, this is true for all people who call on the Lord. And he makes sure you know it because he levels even the distinctions that that culture used to rank people. He says it's independent of sex, sons and daughters. He says it's independent of age, both young men and old men. And class, he says, even my servants will be given the full Holy Spirit on the same level playing field as everybody else and put in the game to be my witnesses. We know that it is happening through Jesus because of what was predicted. And I just couldn't resist but put this verse in. But verse 21 says, and everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. If that isn't good news, I don't know what is. See, the Old Testament told the story that God was going to do something big and miraculous and significant and salvific, and it was happening through Jesus. It was predicted thousands of years before. But it wasn't just predicted long ago. It was witnessed real time by real people. See, the second source of witnesses is the New Testament apostles. We read this in Acts 32 and 33. It says, God raised this Jesus to life, and we are all witnesses of it. Remember, this is Peter talking to a crowd that wants to know about Jesus. He says, God has raised this Jesus to life, and we are all witnesses of it. Exalted to the right hand of God, he has received from the Father the promised Holy Spirit and has poured out what you now see and hear. They are witnesses. I hope you know this. The New Testament documents aren't written generations and generations after the real events. Luke is talking 50 days after Jesus rose from the grave. He's saying, like, just go ask that guy who saw this happen. This isn't theory about the ministry and life, death, resurrection, and ascension and exaltation of Jesus. This is real people in real history seeing real events, just saying, I'm literally just trying to tell you what I saw to be true. And these people that are real eyewitnesses that are giving witness are drawing in more witnesses. They're saying, now you're part of this. You get called off the bench. When you trust in Jesus, you will now be a witness too. So we're nearing the finish line. Can you believe it? It is flying by to me. I hope it is to you. Two questions lead Peter to talk about two events that reveal Jesus' two identities as confirmed by two kinds of witnesses on the basis of which God makes two incredible promises. We see these in verses 38 and 39. It says, Peter replied, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and your children, and amen to this, and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord our God will call. Imagine if you really were aware of the sin that separated you from God, and you heard someone say, Jesus has taken care of it. If you repent and believe and be baptized and go public and receive the Holy Spirit, you will be forgiven. I can't tell you the number of days I wake up and I forget that that's true about me. And it's lost on me. But every once in a while, God grabs my attention, just like we talked about a little bit earlier, and says, you were once far off, and I called you, and I saved you. That is what Peter can't wait to tell a hurting world. God can forgive you. He will liberate you, and not just that. He doesn't just get you back to zero, like I guess you don't have a bad past anymore. He empowers you. He now says that same person who was far off, who was a sinner, who was separated from God, is now going to be my witness. That includes you. That includes me. All right, nearing the finish line. We have two questions. Lead Peter to talk about two events that reveal Jesus' two identities, confirmed by two witnesses on the basis of which Jesus makes two promises on two conditions, repentance and faith. Peter says this. He says, brothers, what shall we do? Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord God will call. He says you have to repent. You might know the definition of this word, right? To do a 180. It doesn't get better than J.I. Packer's definition. I'll just read it in your hearing. Repentance means turning from as much as you know of your sin to give as much as you know of yourself to as much as you know of your God. And hopefully, as your life goes on, every area will increase, that you'll know more of your sin so you can give more of yourself to the God that you know more deeply. And he says, you got to be baptized. Now, don't associate this with like baptize, but being baptized is the thing that saves you. It's still faith in Jesus Christ. But this was something, Peter was throwing down the gauntlet. The Jewish audience listening thought only Gentile believers or non-Jewish believers were the ones who needed baptized. And Peter says, no, everyone needs baptized. You need to go public. You need to put your faith on display. You need other people to know where you stand. And so a Jewish person submitting to baptism in the name of Jesus would have been risky, but it was what God wanted. He wanted them to be able to plant their flag in the ground and say, no, I am aligned with Jesus. Finally, we have arrived at the final of the seven pairs. We see that Jesus asked, or the two questions, what does this mean and what shall we do, led Peter to talk about two events, Christ's death and resurrection, which revealed Jesus' two identities as Lord and Messiah, as confirmed by two witnesses, the Old Testament prophets, the New Testament apostles, on the basis of which God makes two promises, his forgiveness and his Holy Spirit, on two conditions, repentance and faith with baptism, so that we can fulfill two roles, prophet and preacher. And by the way, I'm talking to you, so prophet and preacher. Okay, now before you get super intimidated, I want to tell you what I think these roles really mean. Okay, We see this in Acts 17 and 18. It says, In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. Now, if I were to poll the room right now, before I talk a little bit about it, and I said, how many prophets we got in the house today? I don't know that a ton of hands may go up. Maybe one or two. Love to see you after the service. And hear what you have to say. I'm sure it's fascinating. No, I'm teasing a little bit. I would hope that all of us would raise our hands. Do you know what a prophet did? A prophet made the word of God known. That's it. A prophet made the word of God known. So if that's what a prophet does, now, how many prophets we got in the house? How many people are on the hook for making God's word known? If you know it, you make it known. So when God says, when Peter says, because God said it, that I will pour out my spirit on all people who put their faith in me, all he means, and they will prophesy, he means that once you know God, you make God known. It's not, maybe it's still intimidating, but it's not that complicated. If you have the Holy Spirit, if you know Jesus in a saving way, you are a prophet. It's speaking the words of God. It's exactly what Peter is doing in this moment. He's telling people what it means to follow Jesus. But not just that. I think, even though this isn't a sermon that Peter is doing, that we are all not only supposed to be prophets, that we are supposed to be preachers. Look what Peter does in this passage. In Acts verse 14, he says, then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and addressed the crowd, fellow Jews and all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. Peter is ready. They see this miraculous stuff that God is doing, and they say, what does this mean? And Peter says, I can answer that. That's all he's doing. He's stepping up and saying, what you've seen, this curiosity you have about Jesus, I would just like to explain a couple things about it. And he goes through the life and death and resurrection and ascension of Jesus Christ. And he tells them about it. He is, I mean, again, I'm trying to like let us loosen us up a little bit and not have us call it a sermon so we don't get super intimidated. He is being a witness. He's giving witness. He is telling them what it is to follow Jesus. It says this in verse 22. It says, again, Peter saying, fellow Israelites, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did among you through him, as you yourselves know. If you don't know where to start, start there. Hey, I know you have a question about Jesus. Listen to this. Jesus lived his perfect life, died a sacrificial death, and rose from the grave because of it. God accredited him because of his faithfulness. I think we're all preachers now. And based on this passage, and this is where I'll end before we take communion. There's a great doctrine that comes from this passage that was popularized in the Reformation. It's called the priesthood of all believers. Has anybody ever heard this term before, the priesthood of all believers? It's one of my favorite doctrines. And you know why? Because it gets me out of family prayers at every family event I'm around. Because you know what inevitably happens is the pastor walks in the room and they go, well, you should pray. And I said, listen, I'm off the clock, you know? No, what and my jokes never land, but what I usually say is, you know, priesthood of all believers, and people are like, I don't know what you mean. And I'm like, ha-ha, and then I just leave. No, but what I love about this is, if you take seriously what happened, not just then, but now, in our lives, in our midst, if you follow Jesus, you have the Holy Spirit. And what it does, you know, there was a time when people thought there were only special kinds of people that could mediate the presence of God, that could mediate the words of God. And in this moment, what we just read about, what Peter tried to explain to this wanting audience was that the hierarchy is not like people way up here that are close to God. It's flattened. And now we're all on the hook. We are all given the Holy Spirit. It is the priesthood of all believers. Listen to some of these words written about this doctrine. It says, the doctrine of the priesthood of all believers states that all believers in Christ share his priestly status. Therefore, there is no special class of people who mediate the knowledge, presence, and forgiveness of Christ to the rest of believers. He goes on to say this. He says, although there was a select group of priests in the Old Testament who mediated the knowledge, presence, and forgiveness of God to the rest of Israel, Christ has come and fulfilled the priestly role through his life, death, and resurrection. Therefore, we are all priests to each other. We stand before God and intercede for one another. We proclaim God's word to one another, and we celebrate his presence among us in worship, praise, and fellowship. Moreover, our priestly ministry doesn't terminate upon ourselves. It propels us into the world in service and witness. And one succinct way of saying this is because we know him, we must make him known. Because of what happened at Pentecost, and because of how God designed the Christian life, you're on the hook as much as I'm on the hook. Just because I'm the one up here who got to think about this all week doesn't mean that I have a closer relationship with God. You have 100% full Holy Spirit in your life. And because of that, you get to be a witness in the world. It's not a have to. It's a get to. And so when we see what Peter did in these moments, we see Peter just stepping up from among the 11, could have been any of them, and says, I'll take this one. I know you have questions about Jesus. Let me take a stab at this. That is what God is asking you and I to do. The priesthood of all believers. If you know him, you must make him known. And by the way, I'm sure that sounds intimidating, but you have everything you need. You have the Holy Spirit in your life. Do you know how many times the apostles faced situations where they were worried about what they'd say? And you know what the Bible usually follows that moment with? They said, don't worry about it. God will give you the words to speak. I believe that so deeply. I believe in you because I believe in the God in you. And so as you make your way through this life, through your world, be on the lookout for people saying, what does this mean? And be ready to give an answer. And at the end of it, hopefully they say, well, what does this mean for me? And you can say, repent and believe. And you too will have the Holy Spirit. And you too will be a witness to the God and King of the world. If that isn't exciting, I don't know what is. As we think about how God has positioned all of us uniquely, in spite of our sin, to be witnesses, let's turn our hearts and minds towards him as we pray and lead in to communion right now. Will you pray with me?